Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all. Well, welcome to Evensong tonight. It's the third Sunday in the season of creation. It's also World Childlessness Week. And for us here at the Cathedral, this is Pride Sunday. This is our Pride Evensong. So welcome to you all. Welcome to those who join us on YouTube, particularly those who find themselves in lockdown. And it's great to have our good friend Julian Moses with us as our preacher tonight. And after the service, please do stay on for refreshments and conversation. I invite you to be seated for the psalm.
Here beginneth the eighth verse of the third chapter of the book Esther. Haman said to King Ahasuerus, "There is a certain people scattered and separated among the peoples in all the provinces of your kingdom. Their laws are different from those of every other people, and they do not keep the king's laws, so that it is not appropriate for the king to tolerate them. If it pleases the king, let a decree be issued for their destruction, and I will pay 10,000 talents of silver into the hands of those who have charge of the king's business, so that they may put it into the king's treasuries." So the king took his signet ring from his hand and gave it to Haman, son of Hammedatha, the Agagite, the enemy of the Jews. The king said to Haman, "The money is given to you and the people as well to do with them as it seems good to you." The couriers went quickly by order of the king, and the decree was issued in the citadel of Susa. The king and Haman sat down to drink, but the city of Susa was thrown into confusion. When Mordecai learned all that had been done, Mordecai tore his clothes and put on sackcloth and ashes, and went through the city, wailing with a loud and bitter cry. He went up to the entrance of the king's gate, for no one might enter the king's gate clothed with sackcloth. In every province, wherever the king's command and his decree came, there was great mourning among the Jews, with fasting and weeping and lamenting, and most of them lay in sackcloth and ashes. When Esther's maids and her eunuchs came and told her, the queen was deeply distressed. She sent garments to clothe Mordecai so that he might take off his sackcloth, but he would not accept them. Then Esther called for Hattach, one of the king's eunuchs, who had been appointed to attend her, and ordered him to go to Mordecai to learn what was happening and why. When they told Mordecai what Esther had said, Mordecai told them to reply to Esther, "Do not think that in the king's palace you will escape any more than all the other Jews. For if you keep silence at such a time as this, relief and deliverance will rise for the Jews from another quarter, but you and your father's family will perish. Who knows? Perhaps you have come to royal dignity for just such a time as this." Here endeth the first lesson.
My soul. 14th verse of the 9th chapter of the Holy Gospel according to Mark. When Jesus and his companions came to the disciples, they saw a great crowd around them and some scribes arguing with them. When the whole crowd saw him, they were immediately overcome with awe, and they ran forward to greet him. He asked them, "What are you arguing about?" Someone from the crowd answered him, "Teacher, I brought you my son. He has a spirit that makes him unable to speak, and whenever it seizes him, it dashes him down. And he foams and he grinds his teeth and becomes rigid. And I asked your disciples to cast it out. They could not do so." He answered, "You faithless generation, how much longer must I be with you? How much longer must I put up with you? Bring him to me." They brought the boy to him. When the spirit saw him, it immediately threw the boy into convulsions, and he fell on the ground and rolled about, foaming at the mouth. Jesus asked the father, "How long has this been happening to him?" And he said, "From childhood. It has often cast him into the fire and into the water to destroy him. But if you are able to do anything, have pity on us and help us." Jesus said to him, "If you are able, all things can be done for the one who believes." Immediately the father of the child cried out, "I believe. Help my unbelief." When Jesus saw that a crowd came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, "You spirit that keeps the boy from speaking and hearing, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again." And after crying out, convulsing him terribly, it came out. The boy was like a corpse, that most of them said, "He is dead." But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he was able to stand. When he had entered the house, his disciples asked him privately, "Why could we not cast it out?" He said to them, "This kind can only come out through prayer." Here endeth the second lesson.
Thank you.
believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Let thy continual pity cleanse and defend thy church, and because it cannot continue in safety without thy succour, preserve it evermore by thy help and goodness, through Jesus Christ our Lord. From whom all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works do proceed. Give unto thy servants that peace which the world cannot give, that both our hearts may be set to obey thy commandments, and also that by thee, we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may pass our time in rest and quietness. Through the merits of Jesus Christ, our Saviour.
Amen.
Life Lighten our darkness, we beseech thee, O Lord, and by thy great mercy, defend us from all perils and dangers of this night. For the love of thy only Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Let us pray. Rainbow Christ, you embody all the colours of the world. Rainbows serve as bridges between different realms, heaven and earth, east and west, queer and non-queer. Inspire us to remember the values expressed in the rainbow flag of the lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and queer community. Red is for life, the root of spirit. Living and self-loving Christ, you are our root. Free us from shame and grant us the grace of healthy pride so we can follow our own inner light. With the red stripe in the rainbow, we give thanks that God created us just the way we are. Orange is for sexuality, the fire of spirit. Erotic Christ, you are our fire, the Word made flesh. Free us from exploitation and grant us the grace of mutual relationships. With the orange stripe in the rainbow, kindle a fire of passion in us. Yellow is for self-esteem, the core of spirit. Out, Christ, you are our core. Free us from closets of secrecy and give us the guts and grace to come out. With the yellow stripe in the rainbow, build our confidence. Green is for love, the heart of spirit. Transgressive outlaw, Christ, you are our heart, breaking rules out of love. In a world obsessed with purity, you touch the sick and eat with outcasts. Free us from conformity and grant us the grace of deviance. With the green stripe in the rainbow, fill our hearts with untamed compassion for all beings. Blue is for self-expression, the voice of spirit. Liberator Christ, you are our voice, speaking out against all forms of oppression. Free us from apathy and grant us the grace of activism. With the blue stripe in the rainbow, motivate us to call for justice. Violet is for vision, the wisdom of spirit. Interconnected Christ, you are our wisdom, creating and sustaining the universe. Free us from isolation and grant us the grace of interdependence. With the violet stripe in the rainbow, connect us with others and with the whole creation. Rainbow colors come together to make one light, the crown of universal consciousness. Hybrid and all-encompassing Christ, you are our crown, both human and divine. Free us from rigid categories and grant us the grace of interwoven identities. With the rainbow, lead us beyond black and white thinking to experience the whole spectrum of life. Rainbow Christ, you light up the world. You make rainbows as a promise to support all life on Earth. In the rainbow space, we can see all the hidden connections between sexualities, genders, and races. Like the rainbow, may we embody all the colors of the world. Amen. Almighty God, who has given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplications unto thee, and dost promise that when two or three are gathered together in thy name, thou wilt grant their requests, fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of thy servants, as may be most expedient for them, granting us in this world knowledge of thy truth, and in the world to come, life everlasting. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost, be with us all evermore. Amen.
Welcome once again to Evensong tonight, and please do stay on for refreshments after the service. Tuesday is International Day of Peace, and we have two offerings here at St John's. The first is a world record attempt. Agnes and Teresa Joy are going to try and sing, and they can do it. They're going to sing all 193 national anthems of the nations that are part of the United Nations. And given that it is a world record attempt, they're only allowed a 10-minute break every 2 hours, and the estimate is that it will take them about 6 hours to sing the national anthems. So you can drop in any time between 9:30 and about 3:30 and listen to various national anthems or watch it on YouTube, the Cathedral YouTube channel. We'll celebrate them when they get the world record. In fact, there are 8 record agencies coming to watch. And then at 7 o'clock on Tuesday night, we have the Brisbane Peace Lecture. And this year it will be given by retired Admiral Chris Barry. And I'm sure he'll have some interesting things to say about Afghanistan and submarines. The hymn before the address is Eternal Light, Shine in My Heart. It's sung to the tune Hendra, which was written by Arthur Grimshaw, former dean of this cathedral. We stand as we are able to sing.
May my words be spoken and heard in the name of God, source of all being, eternal word, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I have to admit I am both honoured and a little mystified to be asked to preach tonight. Honoured because a Pride Festival is a wonderful and important thing to celebrate. And especially in my context, of which I will say more shortly. And I'm a little mystified because I feel a bit like an interloper. I cannot help but think that there are others who could preach from within the LGBTQI+ community, and not just as a well-meaning ally, which is how I would describe myself. But here we are, and here I am, and I will try to do this moment justice. Now, I remember Dean Peter saying way back when I was on staff here at St. John's that when it comes to Evensong, it is not really necessary to preach on the readings. And Peter, I don't think I'm giving away any secrets there. But of course, I looked at the readings for tonight and found what I thought was quite a mixed bag, actually. And I'm not sure that I can come to grips with the Mark reading tonight, because on this occasion, it sounds a little bit too much like some other experiences that people in the LGBTQI community have had when evil spirits have been attempted to be cast out of them. I'm not sure I can give that a positive spin. And on another day, I think it's a cracking story, but not tonight. Esther, however, is a gift for anyone who wants to be an ally to the LGBTQI+ community. So it is to Esther's story that I will turn in due course, to explore what it might offer us in this context and in my context. So here is my context, though I think many of you already know it. I am a school chaplain, working in an Anglican girls' school. And just as we take it for granted these days that many of our students are not Anglican, we may also take it for granted that some of them are not girls. Our students come in all shapes, sizes, colours, religions, ethnicities, sexualities, and genders, as do our staff. Sadly, it is part of my daily work and conversation to explain to these people why God hates gay people, or transgender people, or queer people. Because it seems that the parts of our church which would rather demonise the LGBTQI plus community have better marketing than we do. I hang the progress flag outside my office, as does our guidance counsellor. We have had people like the Reverend Dr. Josephine Inkpin speak at assembly, as anyone who reads the Courier Mail will have noticed. I teach gender and sexuality using current scientific and psychological understandings of these themes, that is to say, broadly and positively. We have staff who are partnered with people of the same sex, and they are treasured members of our community. And yet students still come to me tentatively and in great confusion to ask that question. Why does God hate gay people, or trans people, or bi people, or queer people? Now, I don't list any of those actions and attitudes that I just listed because I'm asking for a pat on the back. It is actually my hope that we embody the values of compassion, humility, and inclusiveness for all our staff and students and families, and that it is a basic standard of humanity. It's certainly not deserving of any congratulations. I list them only to say that in spite of these things, LGBTQI plus people expect condemnation from the Anglican Church and from God. Here is some more of my context. Around about year 9, that's students who are 14 to 15 years old, sometimes a little earlier, occasionally a bit later, students will become confident enough to come to a few of their teachers and quietly ask, "Can you please call me by this boy's name from now on?" Some tell us their preferred pronouns are he and him. For others, it will be they and them. Currently, in my Year 9 classes, I have a Danny, an Eret, a Theo, an Alex, which is a deliberately unisex name, and an Aidan. I know of Miles, and last year Zane left us to attend a co-ed school, his choice. And I know that there are others, and they have just not let us into their circle of trust yet, but I'm hopeful that they will. And it isn't just gender identity that presents itself around this time. I just think gender identity is more public. I know that there are plenty of students who identify as lesbian. I know at least one who has publicly said she's bisexual, and one who tells me they are asexual. But these don't demand a change of name or pronoun, so perhaps they can be more covert if they choose. And while I cannot and do not offer counselling to students, I do offer them support and confidence and the assurance that God loves them and that they are enough. I use their chosen names. I am acutely aware that as a chaplain, my responses carry a particular weight with them, because in their eyes I speak for the church. So I am astounded, frankly, when they seek me out and asked me to call them by their new name, because I realise that in some part of their hearts they are afraid I will refuse. This is the legacy our church has to deal with. For whatever reasons, we have allowed exclusionist versions of our faith to be heard most loudly. We have failed to communicate God's love and acceptance in ways that are audible to the LGBTQI+ community. And for this, I am ashamed. And perhaps this is where the story of Esther comes in. I know you've been following Esther's story over the last few Evensongs, this young, beautiful Jewish girl who gets chosen via a nationwide beauty pageant to be the next queen for King Ahasuerus. The king's court, like all courts, is full of intrigue, and there has been a battle for influence between Haman the Agagite and Mordecai the Jew, who happens to be Esther's uncle. Haman comes up with a scheme to get rid of Mordecai by killing all the Jews, but Mordecai learns of the plot, and in desperation he sends word to Esther to intervene on behalf of her people. And these were the final words we heard in the reading tonight. Do not think that in the king's palace you will escape more than all the other Jews. For if you keep silence at such a time as this, relief and deliverance will rise for the Jews from another quarter, but you and your father's family will perish. Who knows? Perhaps you have come to royal dignity for just such a time as this. As I think about our responsibility as a church to the LGBTQI+ community, I think it's twofold. Firstly, we have a responsibility to preach a gospel of love and inclusion, because that is the gospel of Jesus Christ. If we are to be faithful to Christ, we have no choice. And while it could be argued that for many people, God is no longer relevant, and while it is certainly true that the church has probably lost the right to say anything about any topic, given our past failures to protect children and the vulnerable, the fact is that people still care what the church thinks, because they care what God thinks. So, like Esther, we have a responsibility to use our powers for good, for such a time as this. Let us use whatever little authority and voice we have left to preach a gospel of love. Maybe that's why we still have any voice at all. But our other and more important responsibility is to listen. To listen to the LGBTQI+ community, for we do not have the monopoly on God. We need them, you, to tell us about the God they, you, know. Our God is too small, too straight, too white, too male, too English, too little. We need a bigger God. To quote the words of gay poet Francisco Alarcón in his poem Prayer, we want a God as our accomplice, who spends nights in houses of ill repute and gets up late on Saturdays. A God knocked unconscious by the billy club of a policeman at a demonstration. A jobless God, a striking God, a hungry God, a fugitive God, an exiled God, an enraged God, a God who longs from jail for a change in the order of things. We want a more godlike God. I think that when we worship a God who excludes and judges and condemns, we forget the God Jesus showed us. The God who cast out demons, not from little boys, but from those who don't understand. The God who takes us by the hand and leads us home. We forget the godlike God who did suffer and was persecuted and who died to keep the peace. So thank you to those of you from the LGBTQI plus community who remind us of this godlike God. May we have the grace and the courage to speak of this God back to you at such a time as this. Amen.
God's most gracious love and mercy, I commit each one of you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up her countenance upon you and grant you her peace.